Now, Ambarish, of course, is still with us. But what we'll do is we'll shift focus something very interesting from the corporate arena, which is coming through. This is corporate commentary from the very top. Our managing editor, Shireen Bunn, caught up with Michael Maybach on his first visit to India after taking charge as the global CEO of MasterCard. Here are excerpts from that exclusive conversation. Listen in.
A almost physical sense of optimism. I mean, it's probably helped by the fact that you look back on 75 years and then all the achievements. But my reference point was really the visit 4 years ago in 2018. What I see today, particularly through the lens of our business, when we look at the digital economy and how it's growing in India and, you know, the growth rates of UPI and so forth, there is technology put to work at scale in unprecedented ways in India. And as a tech company and as a tech geek, I find that hugely exciting. So I'm going to go back and see there's models emerging in India that we should all think about and see what else we can do and how we evolve our business in partnerships with fintechs and other companies that are using this technology here in India. That was the conversation at the dinner tables last night here in the hotel.
You know, so I just want to take that point forward. From your strategy of buy, build, or sort of partner, where does India fit into that strategy currently, and what is it going to mean in terms of future investments?
So let me just say a few things. We're not a credit card company to start with, so let's just...
I think that transition you've been on for the last couple of years.
Let's just baseline on that. So, as a payment technology company, we kind of broadly speaking, what we do, our strategy is be in payments, whatever choice of payments is there. Like, India is offering a lot more choice in payments than was there even 5 years ago. So it might have been cards, and now it's UPI, it's account to account, it's push payments. You want it, you have it in India. So we want to offer solutions in all those spaces. That's our stated strategy. It's different in different countries. And here in India, certainly there's more choice and better for that. But then that's also the question. So if you have that rapidly rising digital economy with all these different payment choices for people, how do you keep it safe? How do you keep it simple? That's another part of our strategy where we say every kind of service that makes this simple, address the cyber risks, is your digital identity compromised, all those kind of things we take care of, and we then partner. And that comes to the partnership point. We say, on payments, you know, there's a lot of partnerships required, for example, on nascent areas of payments, B2B payments. There's a lot of inefficiency in B2B payments, which we bring solutions to the party. Basic P2P payments. Here in India, UPI is an amazing success. We don't really need to partner on that, but the question on cybersecurity and how do you make sure that these payments remain safe, as this becomes one of the, if not the largest digital economy in the world, that's a partnership area. Then you go into some of the big questions that India is addressing that many other countries will face, and that's the question of an inclusive digital economy. Hundreds of millions of peoples. We think there's going to be 100 million people to join the formal digital economy in India in the next couple of years. Who else? How do you do this? And what partnerships are required? We've been on a financial inclusion trip for years. I ran our Africa business. That's why I got really in tune with that topic. And I think there's amazing drive here on that. There's technology developed here. But we also have experience that we can bring to the party. So all sorts of partnerships across the board. And in my conversation with our employees here, look at us, where's it going? Where's the puck going? What else can we bring to India's journey to make that digital India vision a reality?
So where is the puck going? Especially in the context of financial inclusion, right. Voice commerce, for instance, I know that this is something that you talk about and this is something that you believe in as well. What kind of innovations can we expect out of India that can possibly be exportable?
I think in the end, where it's going to go, pay every which way you want, whenever you want, always on the basis of it's safe and secure. So I think that's the headline. And, you know, that turns out in many different ways. It's going to be paying in the metaverse. It's going to be paying through voice. It's going to be paying offline in areas of the country where you have no GSM coverage or it's not as good as it needs to be. So every bit of technology that's there today is going to give us a huge boost because all that is at disposal in India. So I wouldn't think there is one particular technology. My general answer on when I think about the future of payments and the future of technology is convergence of a lot of fundamental underlying technologies, AI, 5G or 6G, cloud, edge computing, all of that will make sure that you can do whatever you want whenever you want it in terms of payments at all times. This is converging, gives you all sorts of data. I think the question of trust and security is really the most important in a digital economy. Imagine that small business that is starting to, is reopening the doors after COVID, and then now they have a digital business because they felt that during COVID that was a thing, and now they're going to operate in a different way than they had before, but they have not learned how to keep their business safe. That trust issue, if something goes wrong, that's going to be a problem, not only for that one business, because people talk, and then the whole small and micro businesses. I think I'm not going to take all the potential from the digital economy. So trust and security is super important. That's what we stand for, what we bring. And it was a good part of the conversations with government as well here.
And don't forget to catch the full conversation at 6:30 p.m. and 9:30 p.m. only on CNBC TV 18. Well, time to slip into a short break. You come back. We'll continue our focus on the markets. The final 10 minutes coming up.